Just, are you kidding me? Do we really need to add this into our milks? Seriously? Ugh, super frustrating. Hello, angels, and welcome to the Glucose Goddess Show. I'm Justine Chespet, a biochemist obsessed with helping you understand your body and your health. And today, my dear coffee lovers, we are discussing, you guessed it, coffee. First things first, coffee seems to be a generally healthy, good for you drink, as long as you don't overdo it. So generally, a cup of coffee a day seems pretty fine. Personally, I've recently cut down on my coffee consumption just because I'm super sensitive to it. And if I have even one cup of coffee in the morning at 8 a.m., then I have a harder time falling asleep at night. But that's just me personally. If you're a coffee lover and you drink coffee, again, seems to be generally safe. Studies show us that people who regularly consume coffee have a reduced risk of developing type 2 diabetes. And scientists think that this could be due to two different mechanisms of action. The first interesting one is that in the liver, coffee has been shown to improve fat burning and lower the risk of NAFLD, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, which is incredibly common. And second, in the pancreas, and this one I think is really interesting and cool, coffee may reduce the stress of the mitochondria in your beta cells. And your beta cells are the cells responsible for creating insulin. So coffee may actually help them function more properly. Again, this is a minor thing. Generally, if you want to improve your health and your glucose levels and your insulin levels, of course, looking at food first is going to be the solution. But this is quite cool as well. However, interestingly, if you've ever worn a glucose monitor, you might have seen something really interesting. You might have seen that black coffee, no sugar in it, actually creates sometimes a small glucose spike. Now, this is a graph showing you me drinking coffee versus Alan drinking coffee. As you can see, in Alan, it creates a bigger glucose spike than in me. So what does this actually mean? Well, in some people, coffee can actually increase your stress levels and your stress hormones a little bit. And so your body may be releasing extra glucose in your bloodstream as a response to this stress. And stress is something that's very interesting. Personally, I saw the biggest glucose spike I had ever seen ever in my body after giving a presentation in front of a lot of people and having a big rush of stress. I saw a massive, massive, massive spike. So your body can respond to a stressful situation or the perceived notion of stress by releasing some glucose into your bloodstream. So if you're somebody that gets quite anxious when they drink coffee, maybe it makes you a little bit jittery, maybe you feel not great afterwards, it could be causing a small glucose spike. But there's a really interesting study that I want to cover that completely blew my mind. If you're somebody who drinks coffee in the morning, and if you often wake up feeling a bit tired, which I think most of us do, well, this recent study shows us that if you've just had a bad night's sleep and you want to make sure your glucose levels are as steady as possible for the rest of the day, it is much better to drink your coffee after eating breakfast than before eating breakfast. The study is called Glucose Control Upon Waking is Unaffected by Hourly Sleep Fragmentation During the Night, but is Impaired by Morning Caffeinated Coffee. And drinking your coffee after breakfast instead of before, if you're tired and didn't have a good night's sleep, can reduce the glucose spike of your breakfast by up to 50%. And you know that if you have a big spike in the morning, your whole day is going to be a glucose roller coaster. So it's really important in the morning, whenever you can, to try to keep your glucose levels as steady as possible. So if this is something that's easy for you, highly recommend trying it out and see how you feel. Oh, and an important note about this study, it also showed that your insulin spikes will be smaller if you drink your coffee after breakfast rather than before. So it's not just a glucose spike, it's also the insulin response, which is almost even more important than glucose alone. I often get the question, well, what if I don't eat breakfast? Well, in that case, you can't really do this hack, So don't worry about it. There's lots of other stuff that you can do to make sure your coffee doesn't spike your glucose levels. Let's talk about what you put in your coffee, So an espresso or black coffee like this generally is not gonna spike your glucose levels. Smells so good. So it's generally not gonna spike your glucose levels. But of course, if you add sugar to your coffee, that's gonna create a glucose spike. Sugar is made up of sucrose, which is half glucose, half fructose. So every time you add sugar to something, actually, let me go get a little cube of sugar so I can demonstrate. Let's see this in close up. Coffee, sugar cube goes into the coffee. Now, I don't have a spoon with me right now, so this is gonna feel a little bit strange. I'm just gonna put the sugar in the coffee and then I'm not gonna mix it in. So forgive me. Maybe I'll put it on the side here so we can kind of see it. No, we cannot see it. Okay, the sugar has disappeared in the coffee. So when you do this, you're adding all of these molecules of sucrose into your coffee. And sucrose, when we eat it or drink it, then breaks down into glucose and fructose in our system. So a coffee with sugar in it is going to create a glucose spike because it's going to release glucose molecules as we digest it. And especially if you have your coffee with sugar on an empty stomach in the morning, that's gonna create a big glucose spike. Because when we are fasted, when there's nothing in our system, anything we drink or we eat is gonna go really quickly to our bloodstream and create a really big spike. So if you start your days with coffee and sugar, big glucose spike, that's gonna lead to cravings, fatigue, hunger, inflammation, bigger risk for diabetes, hormonal imbalances. So that's really something to avoid if you can. What can you do instead of sugar? Now, ideally, you'd want to slowly wean yourself off of needing that sweet taste, but good alternatives are things like monk fruit or stevia that you can put in your coffee. You can also try cinnamon or cocoa powder. I know it sounds weird, but it's super good if you sprinkle some on top, and maybe that'll give you the little hint of sweetness that you like without a big glucose spike. Hey, really quickly, if you can't always do my food hacks and you want to eat the carbs that you love with less impact on your glucose levels, I created a capsule just for that. It's called Anti-Spike Formula. You take two before a meal, it cuts the glucose spike of carbs by up to 40%, 100% made out of plants and tested by over 25 clinical trials. Link is in the description. Okay, back to the episode. How about we cover milk? I'm personally a big flat white fan, you know, cappuccinos or any of those delicious coffee and milk drinks. So what's the deal with milk? What happens when we add milk to our coffee? The answer is it completely depends on what milk you're adding. Big oat milk craze right now. Unfortunately, and I know a lot of people are gonna hate me for saying this, but oat milk is not a good option. So oat milk comes from oats, and oats are a grain. They're cereal, right? So oats, like all grains and cereal, are full of starch. Starch is essentially just long chains of glucose molecules attached together. And when we digest starch, they break down into individual glucose molecules, make their way to our bloodstream, and zoo, create a glucose spike. So when you add oat milk to your coffee, you are essentially adding liquid starch. You are adding just a bunch of glucose molecules, and that creates a big spike. So yeah, oat milk is not the best option. If you really, really, really love it and you can't live without it, there's a few things that you can do. So first of all, as I mentioned, avoid it on an empty stomach. Anything on an empty stomach is gonna lead to a bigger glucose spike if it contains any glucose. If you're a big oat milk lover, having it after your breakfast instead of before, not only is it gonna help with what we saw earlier about the sleep deprivation impact, but also, because you'll already have food in your stomach, all of the starch from the oats are gonna be slowed down through your system. And the glucose molecules are gonna arrive more slowly into your bloodstream, creating a smaller glucose spike. Now, if you're ready to say goodbye to oat milk, which I recommend, there's other alternatives out there that are not gonna spike your glucose levels. What you want is you want to look for either dairy, so regular cow's milk, or nut milks. So good options are things like almond milks, pistachio milk, coconut milk, macadamia milks. Because nuts are quite high in protein and fat, so they're not just glucose. And when you drink a nut milk, let's say almond milk, you're not just getting a bunch of glucose like you are in an oat milk. You're also getting some proteins and some fats. And proteins and fats do not raise our glucose levels. They keep our glucose levels steady. Now, a very important thing to mention here. If you go to a coffee shop and you ask for almond milk or any kind of nut milk, I kind of recommend you ask to see the box that it came in, the bottle that it came in, because if you have a look in the ingredients, you might actually see that there's added sugar in there. So you might see the ingredients being like almonds and then cane sugar. You really want to avoid that. I had this thing recently where I saw this coffee shop was offering pistachio milk. So I thought, ooh, how cool, pistachio milk. I've never tried that before. And then I asked to see the bottle and it was ingredients, pistachios, cane sugar. Just, are you kidding me? Do we really need to add this into our milks? Seriously? Ugh, super frustrating. So I then ended up just switching back to asking for whole milk because whole milk is protein and fat, very small amount of sugar, naturally occurring, not going to raise your glucose levels significantly. So I went for whole milk, which is generally the option that I choose. But if you can, ask to see the ingredients. And if you're doing this at home, just buy some unsweetened version of almond milk or coconut milk or any other nut milk that you're interested in. Other milks that are quite similar to oat milk, because they also come from grains, are rice milk, barley milk. All of those kinds of milk are going to be 100% glucose because they're just starch. And if this is sounding a little complicated, like you can't keep track of which milks are good and which milks are bad, I have a free recap one-pager PDF linked in the description of this episode that'll give you a nice table with all the different types of milks and which one you should have, which ones you should avoid. But so generally, unsweetened nut milk is going to be good. Try to avoid any milks that come from grain or just pure starch. And then finally, I find to be a very good option just to ask for some whole milk. If you can handle dairy well, it's a good source of protein, good source of fat, and is going to be a safer option in most cases if you're going to a coffee shop. Now here's a little graph showing you the difference between an oat matcha latte and a whole milk matcha latte. Big difference, as you can see, because oat milk, again, 100% starch, turns to glucose, big spike. Whole milk, mostly protein and fat, small spike, so you feel better. And the rest of your day is not dictated by a big glucose roller coaster that's going to make you have lots of cravings and be tired. Another cool difference to note is if you look at the glucose spike of whole milk versus skim milk, you can see that skim milk creates a bigger spike than whole milk. Now, why is that? Well, because milk has some naturally occurring sugar called lactose, and lactose breaks down to glucose as we digest it. There's a little bit of it in there. It's not nearly as much glucose as you would find in some oat milk or rice milk, which is why I prefer to have the dairy. But skim milk takes away the fat in the milk, and fat actually slows down glucose release in the body and prevents glucose spikes. So whole milk has naturally occurring fat in it that's gonna curb the spike of the milk. But when you take the fat out, there's less to curb the spike, so the spike is bigger. And another final study that's really interesting that I wanted to show, this is one showing that the provenance of the coffee beans also seems to have an impact on whether the coffee is gonna create a spike in your body or not. This study is called Differences in the Effects of Kenyan, Tanzanian, and Ethiopian Coffee Intake on Glucose Levels, Measured with a Freestyle Libre, a Pilot Case Study. Now, this was a tiny, tiny, tiny study in one person, but still got published. And I think it's pretty interesting. This one person in Japan found that the Kenyan coffee led to significantly smaller glucose spikes compared to the two other coffees, the Tanzanian and the Ethiopian. Now, we can't really draw any conclusions from such a small study, but this is something that might warrant some more research. I think it's pretty interesting. So to recap, black coffee is fine for you. Avoid sugar, add some stevia, cinnamon, cocoa powder if you want some sweetness. The milk you put in your coffee is super important. Try to avoid oat milk, rice milk, go for dairy, go for regular cow's milk or unsweetened nut milks. And finally, if you're somebody who is tired in the morning generally, try to have your coffee after your breakfast instead of before, and that can help your glucose levels. And that is all we have time for today. Thank you for being here. I'll see you next time.